If it doesn't have a C in a circle, is it protected? That's the first question. Is this true or false? Do you need a C in a circle to have copyright on a piece of work? No, of course you don't. Copyright's automatic. As soon as it's created, it's protected. It's not 20%. Is it 10%? Can I copy 10% without infringing? Is that true? Who thinks yes? I can copy 10% of a work, I'm not infringing, that's fine. Who thinks that's nonsense?
I was told that at college.
Oh, yeah. We get told these facts. Someone was told 20%. You were told 10%, were you?
Yeah.
I've heard 5%. All of this is nonsense. Sorry? How would you quantify that? You cannot copy a piece of work that someone else has created. And what you've got to look at is not percentage of work created, but is it substantial of the work it's copied? Is it a substantial amount of work that has been copied in the original product? Now, if 1% of the work that you've copied, if you've copied 1%, and that 1% is substantial, or the substantial body of that work, you've got copyright. Okay? You can get inspiration from previous works, but you can't directly copy. What about then, can I copy this 10% as long as I acknowledge the work? Is that okay? Subject to separate issues, obviously, that you can overrule any of the above by statement in contracts, generally. But generally,
no.
Even if you acknowledge it, you generally can't use it. You need permission from the author, in which case you'll still generally have to acknowledge them as well. There might be certain scenarios that allow you to do this, subject to whether or not it's become open source. Or there might be certain exclusions, which we'll come onto a little bit later, that you allow you a little bit of flexibility as to what you can do. I've bought the book painting photograph, I can do with it as I wish. True? No, nonsense, obviously. I've bought a book, doesn't mean I can make copies of it. Copyright's quite an old right, dates back to 1709, but obviously wasn't really considering digital back then. I'm sure we'd kind of understand why. Okay, but obviously over the years, scope has been increased and increased and increased. And like I said, actually last year, in October last year, we adapted it slightly a little bit more, pretty much because of the digital world. Okay, one of the changes was in the exclusions. Personal private use is now an accepted exclusion to copyright. I've bought a DVD or a piece of a CD, let's say a music CD. Who here is actually a question? Who here is infringed copyright? Yeah, it's on camera. Who has infringed copyright? Now, I'm going to say everyone. Okay, the reason for this, has anyone here bought a CD? I'm assuming everyone here has bought a music CD at some point. Has everyone here put it on their computer and copied the files on their computer? Yes, we've all done that, I'm assuming. I haven't, clearly. That's a breach of copyright, or was a breach of copyright. Before October the 1st, that was format shifting. You've now created another version of copyright, of other copyright works, which is the piece of music on a CD and on your computer. That was originally a breach. Subject to the 2014 personal use, personal private use, we said, nah, that's fine. So as of October the 1st, 2014, that's okay. But before October the 1st, you've all breached copyright. Okay, easily done. Okay, obviously the point that we've changed this is because, you know, back in 1709, they didn't see this happening. And this, although technically a breach, isn't really what copyright's there to stop. So we said, that's okay. Okay, and there's a few exclusions that will apply as well. Okay, so everyone but me has infringed. Well done, good to establish that. Copyright conventions, these Universal Copyright Convention, Berne Convention, and the trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights. Okay, essentially what these means, you can have a read of them if you like. I wouldn't recommend it. Basically, they mean copyright is an international right. You create a piece of copyright work, as long as you can prove it's yours and that you created it, you own it everywhere in the world, more or less.
Excuse me, what if you take a photo of a piece of art, like...
Oh, okay.
You know, someone, Turner or someone, let's say,
yep.
Use that.
Taking a photo of a piece of copyright work would be an infringement of copyright in itself. You've created another version of copyright based on that piece of copyright.
But does that piece still have a copyright?
If the original art has copyright within it, subject to the rules that we'll go through soon, then taking a photo of that piece of copyright is breaching copyright. So your photo would actually have its own copyright in it because you've taken that photo. But you would be infringing the artist's copyright in their painting because you've changed the format on which it's on, and also you've made a copy of their work.
But if the originator is long gone,
subject to copyright law, we'll come on to the length of copyright in a moment, but yeah, if it's out of copyright, then you haven't breached copyright because there's no copyright on it, and you would own that photo. But you would not own the concept of taking a photo of that painting. Someone else could come along and take a photo of that painting themselves. They're not infringing your copyright because you don't own the concept of photographing that piece of art. If someone took your photo and copied your photo, that would actually breach your copyright in that instance, yes. Okay, does that make sense? We're all clear?
I'm not sure.
Not more confused, anyone?
So some of the photography libraries that I have to use, I'm not sure of their provenance.
Have you not noticed the sign that says no photographs? Because a lot of them have them.
Sorry?
A lot of them have no photographs. They say because it affects the artwork.
Digital libraries who sell online.
Yes, so if you've got digital libraries online.
You sell reproductions of let's say, old masters. Now, I don't know whether they have. How do they get the rights to sell these on? Because
so the digital library using a piece of work that's out of copyright. Are you talking?
Yeah, like an old master's.
That piece of work is out of copyright, so they have the right to photograph it as they wish, and then they can license that photograph to you because they own copyright in that photo.
Do they not have the current owner's permission?
Only if it's within copyright, so which is why we're saying if it's out of copyright. If it's within copyright, they need the permission. And we'll come on to the duration in a moment, if that helps. When we come to the duration, hopefully it'll make it clear, okay?
So if the National Trust owns painting,
yes, they own the physical painting. Probably going to be out of copyright, yeah?
Yeah. They can't stop you taking a picture of it.
If it's on their premises and there's a sign saying on receipt of, you know, or the ticket says no photographs,
yeah.
You've breached contract in taking a photo, therefore you have, although it's not a copyright issue, it's a contract issue that relates to copyright. So that's how they'd stop you. So that's, again, that's a reason why cinemas would stop you taking videos in a cinema, because they understand that actually you are breaching copyright in videoing the film, but you are also creating your own copyright in filming it. Okay? But if
you do that now?
No. Because they've got a specific statement saying you're not allowed to do that.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's generally why most of the museums will have those statements in there to prevent an issue. Yeah, one more before we move on. Yeah? Again, subject to the Sistine Chapel, if they've said photographs are okay, then you can take a photograph of it. And you've taken a photograph, you've breached contract in when you've entered the building. Sorry? In which case, they might have permitted people to take photographs of it separately for them to license out. They might have taken the photos themselves to license out. So they're profiting from it. If you've walked in and taken a photo, you've breached contract, not necessarily copyright, unless it's still within copyright, which the fairly confident in saying that the Sistine Chapel is not covered by copyright anymore because, you know, it's expired. It's quite a long time ago. Yeah. If they say you can't do it, you can't do it. If you've done it, you've breached contract. That's not copyright law, that's contract law. Okay. There'll be photos out there somewhere that you can pay a license to use. And generally what will have happened there is they've allowed people to take photos for a certain fee, or it might be their own official photos that they're making money off. Okay. Does that make sense? Good. Okay, copyright must subsist in a material form. So a sound recording would have sounds on it. If it's a sound recording of a piece of music,
yeah.
That's going to be 70 years after the death of the author of that. So taking that and doing aspects with that may infringe the original creator's work.
Former in the sound recording still alive, then
yes, then they would have their own rights in that involved as well, okay, and theirs would still exist under a separate aspect of copyright, okay, because it's for different aspects of what you're creating. So again, look at the website as another example. Your website's got pictures, it's got text, it's got the layout, and it's got the coding. Generally, different people have created all of these aspects. And the copyright in each of those aspects will expire 70 years after that person dies, or that group of people dies. So you might find in that website, the photos on that website have expired today, but the text might still be in copyright because the person has only died 50 years ago. Yeah? And or it depends on the piece of work that they're creating, they're playing as well. It would be the creator of that work as well.
So I'm not sure where the publication.
So that's for the sound recording itself, the specific sound recording that they create.
Yeah.
Okay. But the aspects within that sound recording would be different.
But could I take that original sound recording?
No.
Put it on my website for.
Depending on the other rights, so not necessarily.
I'm not altering the recording, I'm using it as it is.
Depends on those other rights involved as well. Okay? Have a chat later, okay?
Could you explain the typographical
layout? So typographical layout, the layout of a website or the layout of a newspaper page are all typographical layouts because they've been designed in a certain instance.
Published 25 years ago.
So the layout of the paper, newspaper or the website, the layout specifically is covered by typographical arrangement. That's not the content within that. That's the fact that you've got the picture there, the writing down here, the heading up there, you know, that layout specifically is what's covered by copyright there. Okay? Michael Jackson's number one. $140 million last year alone from his copyright works, despite being dead. Elvis is number two, so well done, he is in there. $55 million every year. He's about 35 years into that expiration. And that's the rest of the list. Database rights, an aspect of copyright, but also kind of somewhat linked as a slightly separate aspect. Okay, database rights can last for 15 years from making. But if they're published in this time, they'll be 15 years from the publication. So if they're made and published, they're protected then. But if they're kept secret and later they're published, it'll be 15 years from that. So similar concept to what we just discussed. Okay, the owner of copyright is the creator of copyright. The only exceptions to this is if you write it in a contract or is if you're employed to do so. If you're employed to do so and it's your job, your business will own it. Okay, employees are not subcontractors, or subcontractors are not employees, sorry. Therefore, subcontractors, what they create external, they are the creator, they are the author, they own it. And it's their death that you look at for when it's going to expire, even if you then own it in the future. You will have moral rights over a work, so creator generally holds moral rights in a work, so right to object to derogatory treatment of a work, for example. Right to be named as author, all these things, non-economic rights will be affected under that. Have we seen this photo? This was a case that was taken in the US. Photography, I think there's a few photographers here, be of interest to you. That's not David Slater, just to clarify. David Slater took his camera into the jungle to take photos of macaques. That's a macaque, that's a female macaque, I believe. Set up the camera in the jungle. This lady picked up the camera, took a photo of herself, named or dubbed the monkey selfie. Okay, it was taken to court in the US because the National Geographic used this on the front page of their magazine without asking David Slater's permission. So it went all the way to court and they had to discuss who owned it. So in the US, bear in mind, not in the UK, who do you think owns monkey? The monkey? Monkey created the photo, did he? Or did David create the photo? Who created the photo?
David.
Why did David own create it? Sorry.
It's his camera that was set up.
Yeah, all right, fair enough. It's his camera, he set it up. Arguably, though, Kodak put the camera together, or other camera manufacturers are available. There you go.
Whoever captures the instance.
Yeah. If you say that David owns it because he set it up, then Kodak put it together. And David wouldn't have been able to set it up if Kodak hadn't put it together for him. Therefore, Kodak should own the copyright. Is that a reasonable argument?
No, sure, he's bought the camera off Kodak.
Yeah. And the monkey borrowed the camera off him.
This is monkey business.
This is monkey, yeah. We're talking bananas here, aren't we? It's nonsense. If he'd set up a timed photo, that's a different matter. Yeah. But who created this specific photo?
The monkey.
The monkey, yeah? Because the monkey pressed the button. Therefore, who owns it?
Monkey.
Monkey? Do we all agree the monkey? Come on, guys. Yeah, well done. A monkey owning copyright? Are you talking nonsense? In the US, they specifically state in their law that monkeys or animals cannot own copyrights. Only human beings can own copyright, because that's logical and reasonable, guys. Yeah? Therefore, a monkey cannot possibly own the copyright in this photo, because he's an animal. Or she's an animal, sorry. Therefore, oh, there you go. Who owns it then? Is it David? Because monkey doesn't own it, therefore David should own it. Or is it nobody? It's nobody. In the US, no one owns this photo. Because it was created by a monkey. It was not created by David, as they argued. At the end of the day, if the monkey does own the copyright, what's and you infringe and you take this photo and use it, what's the monkey going to do? It's going to go ape. I did tell you they get worse. I did warn you, so don't argue. All right. But it's a very bizarre scenario. I think it's happened with an elephant. Elves don't exist. Elephant. I said elf because they actually dubbed that one Elfie. All right. So it probably cost a fair whack going to court. You know, because at the end of it was a valuable photo. It was a very bizarre scenario. Okay. Could have claimed it was his and that he took the photo, but it wouldn't have been worth so much. Because if he took the photo, it's just another photo of a macaque. Yeah, because it was a monkey selfie, that's why it was so valuable. So he couldn't say the monkey didn't take it, because then it would be worthless. Or not worthless, just not as worth as much. Okay? So he had to state that the monkey created it, which was his own downfall. So did he employ the monkey? Did he pay him X bananas? No, that doesn't work, I'm afraid.
Who was it that was trying to sue who?
David was trying to stop National Geographic or sue them for breach of copyright.
But presumably he had published that picture somewhere, so therefore he had copyright of the publication.
No, because the photo itself is owned by the monkey. If he'd have changed the photo and then published it, he would own the copyright in the adapted version. And you would be breaching the copyright in using his adapted version. Therefore, he could have argued copyright breach there, but that wouldn't protect the original product. But as he had the original product, you might have argued what he should have done is kept that one secret, adapted it, then released it. Because then he would arguably own copyright in the only available version of it.
The uniqueness of that probably was the fact that
it was a monkey selfie. Yeah, that was the fact. You could go out and take a photo of a macaque yourself. There's nothing stopping you doing that. And there's tons of photos of macaques. He'd shown it. It was available online, and people have got access to it. So therefore, it was available. Tough. No, not necessarily. This obviously wasn't based in case precedent, so we didn't really know what the law was before that. You know, you might have been able to figure it out, but the law is an uncertain thing.
But if he'd have published a low-res version of a picture online.
And he could have had the high-res version himself and sold the high-res version. Yeah, he could have done that because he was the one who actually had access to it. Yeah, maybe he could have done that himself. Hindsight, there was a few things he might have been able to do, but he didn't. Okay? Happens in software industry as well, a bit, obviously not with monkeys. Business Links versus Limited versus Clear Springs in this instance. What happened was Business Links produced software, Clear Springs licensed it out without permission of the original owner. Okay. They argued in this licensing agreement from Business Links, or the use of it, that they had rights, existing assignment and existence of all future copyrights in that work. Okay. And in the court, they looked at not just the contract, but evidence of negotiation, written estimation, you know, if there was any indication of this type of right being applied. However, it was established that Clear Springs had a non-exclusive license, which means Business Links have licensed it to them, but they're also entitled to license it to anyone else themselves. Okay. And there was no right of ownership assigned over or sublicense. So even though it was licensed, then they didn't have the right to do anything further with that. Okay? If there's more than one author, more than one creator of a piece of work, as we discussed earlier, it's joint own. Unless you can identify who did what. So if there's two forms of, or if there's a piece of software created by a combination of authors, and you can't identify who created which aspects of which lines, then it's owned by everyone. If you can identify, I created the first half of it, you created the second half of it, I own the first half, you own the second half, that's clear. In which case, separate ownership in different aspects. Okay? But if you want to license out or do anything with that work, you must have both parties agreeing where it's joint ownership. If one party says, no, I don't want to do that, then tough, you can't do it. Even if you own half of it. Does it protect ideas? Concepts or functions or ideas around it, as we've discussed, are not protected by copyright. In this instance, we had no copyright infringement when a company which does not have access to the source code of a program studies, observes, and tests the program to observe what it does and creates another one that does the same thing. They're not copying the code. They're not copying this because they don't have access to the code. They're just copying what the function is. The concept around it. They've identified what it does and figured out how to do that themselves. They haven't copied the code. If they had access to the source code, then that would be an infringement because they have copied directly the source code then. Open source works. Not necessarily copyright free. Generally, you might need a license to use it. Okay, and you might have certain conditions met involved in this as well. Okay, and it can be quite a complex issue, but sometimes people have open source software that can be used generally freely, and a lot of businesses and a lot of industries will use this. Something to be aware of: what is it you're allowed to use it for? What are you using it with? Can you commercialize it? What are the agreements behind the use of that software, that use of that open source? And if you're using it in open, or if you're producing open source as well, what are you actually happy with other people using that for as well? Okay.
See the open source stuff? If you have a piece of code that in the license for it, it clearly says you can use it for commercial purposes and adapt it as you wish. If you adapt it to increase the functionality of it, you then own the copyright of that.
You would own the copyright in the new version,
yeah.
Or the adapted version, yes. Okay, and it might be in the contract of the use of the original one that they say any adaptations are also open source. That might be a term in there, so you wouldn't necessarily, you would be the owner or the creator of that copyright, but subject to the terms and conditions, it might be that that's also subject to open source, which might argue is fair. Okay, but yes, you would own the adapted version. Okay, you'd own the adapted version even if you breached copyright to do so, but you'd just be limited as to what you could and couldn't do with it. Okay? Any of the following is an infringement without the consent of the owner: copying, reproducing, adaptation, distributing, lending, public performance. Who plays the radio in their office? Okay. Anyone else? Or no one else willing to admit it? I think there's a few people on the side. You're out of the camera shot, so you're more than welcome to put your hand up here. Yeah, all right. If you play the radio in your office without a PRS and PPL license to do so, you are infringing copyright via public performance. Your office is a public place, and playing the radio out loud is a performance. You're infringing copyright, unless you have a PRS, PPL license. If you have those licenses, you're generally okay.